Hello there, you beautiful people. My name is Willow, and welcome back to Supreme Commander Forge Lines Forever for a Step-Stool Laddercast. And today, we're going to be looking at a beautiful map called Loki, and two beautiful players playing Aeon and Cybern, respectively. Let's go ahead and get into player introductions, starting in the northeast with the red Cybern going first. Land, his name is mrhatnclaws, and he is rocking this northern position as we move down to the southern position to see a blue Aeon going first. Land got his build order queued up, and his name is, of course, xRawxLegitx. Round two, Electric Boogaloo. xRawxLegitx was very entertaining in the last step stool, and he is now starting to become a bit of a staple. He plays very interesting games. And really quick, I was streaming, so let's go ahead and get the audio levels fixed. Just get it to a very, you know, nice level there. And of course, remind you to like, comment, and subscribe, or dislike if you don't like the video. Helps out the channel a ton when you subscribe, helps out the channel a ton when you like, and it is just generally good for me to tell you to do so because you all do it more when I do. So, let's talk about the map. Let's look at this oh-so-classic map, been around since the days of old, and of course, 3,100 reclaim around about, and we have these different levels of terrain and this kind of city in the middle, which, honestly, this city just looks so good. That'll be the thumbnail. It'll be like the city living cast or something, I don't know, but we do have this city in the middle. It does kind of mess up pathing. You can come over here and very quickly reclaim these walls and get a very nice way to push through the middle of the map. But generally what we're going to see is players fighting over the flanks. This player on this side is going to be trying to expand kind of north, get these three mexes, and trying to get over here to this corner. Both sides pushing towards the corners as fast as possible is the general way the game is going to play out. And both sides going to just be trying to punch each other in the face, as, of course, that's the way you win FAF games. You gotta get some units, you gotta send them forward, and you gotta blow some stuff up that doesn't belong to you, and hopefully not leave too much reclaim behind where your opponent can get it. Of course, this is Step-Stool Laddercast. Last game, I noticed a lot of people not really familiar with the way the series works, so I guess I should probably explain it. Both of these players are below 1,000 rating on the 1v1 ladder, and the sister series to this is Subpar Commander, where everybody has to be 1,000 or below on the 4v4, 2v2, or custom games global rating ladders. And that is how we determine if the game is a high or low rated game. This is here to show off some of the players that would never get casted by other big casters. So we're here to just show off the true level of FAF. The most players are below 1,000 rating in this game, so let's show it off. And of course, over here to the east, we have ourselves a bunch of engineers out here expanding for mrhatnclaws. Both sides have air on the way. Seems as though xRawxLegitx got air up a little bit faster. Either that, or he just gave his order to his scout a little bit faster. And xRawxLegitx just sending his comm up north. Normally, I think you see the comm try and go for this expansion, or sometimes all the way over here to these three mexes. Generally, this side of the map and this side of the map are worth more because you get seven mexes. Versus going for the other corner, you get, I guess the other corner is where your opponent is, isn't it? Well, if you expand this way, you get two mexes and four mexes, and you could maybe get these three, but these three will usually be grabbed up by your opposition. And both sides just kind of chilling right now. xRawxLegitx has an idle commander, but that's actually going to come in useful for him, as he's going to kill off two separate hunter labs, and that's going to be very, very nice to see. Over here to the east, we have a T1 bomber out, already managing to pick up a kill. That was a kill onto a flare, I believe, which is very, very useful. And the Zeus over here just going to continue its reign of destruction, try and find more things to shoot down. The commander of xRawxLegitx now making its way towards the middle. I don't think there's a ton of reclaim to be had by reclaiming all these buildings. I'm not 100% sure. Somebody in the comments will definitely let us know. But it may be a really good idea to just reclaim all of these buildings, in fact. And over here to the south, we have that T1 bomber. It bombed a mech, but may turn around and go for that engineer. And if it does get it, that is going to be a little bit huge. The early engineers on these 1v1s, so important to keep alive. And right now, it does seem as though Mr. Hat and Claws has a bit of a better understanding of how to expand. He's already ahead on mass generation. He's already getting some decent kills with the bomber. And xRawxLegitx is having a bit of a struggle over here. He is getting these buildings reclaimed, and yeah, it would seem that these buildings are worth next to nothing. So we can answer that question on our own. He's reclaiming as many as he really can, but they're not really giving him too much. Looks as though he wanted to maybe chase down that Mantis, but not gonna happen. He does have an engineer that's gonna go down there in the middle. And yeah, his reclaim is not going up by much. They're worth like 5-6 mass each, which makes not much sense because, you know, that's a big building. The ACU is multiple stories tall. Like, these are skyscrapers, pretty much. And they're worth practically nothing. So, very interesting to see that. Over here to the south, another mass extractor going to be going down to the hands of Mr. Hattenclaws, who is just oh so happy to be showing his early aggression. Two bombers out onto the field, one of them the one from earlier, and he's really just stifling the expansion of Mr. xRawxLegitx on the other side. These two misters going ham for the sisters, I don't know. Me saying stupid shit on the internet, name a better combo. Or me and saying stupid shit on the internet. So, two Zeuses takes down a T1 mass extractor, so he's gonna be able to just start killing off these periphery mass extractors. This engineer probably not too long for this world, unfortunately, and there comes in the second bomber to just make sure it dies. And here comes a death onto the second mass extractor. That is gonna be the bomber going down, but the more experienced bomber, the one with 5 kills, gonna be able to stay alive. A few interceptors coming in, from Mr. Hat and Claws. They're going to just pass right by those interceptors. So these two interceptors out from xRawxLegitx maybe gonna be able to chase down both of these bombers. One bomber going down, another one got in their sights. And the interceptors responding for Mr. Hat and Claws are going to show up. Are they gonna be able to kill off the interceptors before they get that second bomber? That's the question. No, they will not. So all of the bombers for Mr. Hat and Claws have now been taken down. Seems as though xRawxLegitx still interested in reclaiming all this stuff in the middle. Not really getting a ton of value though. He's still behind reclaim-wise despite spending so much time on this. And now gonna be going for gun range. The Aeon, oh so different from everybody else, having gun range and speed on two different arms. So you get two gun upgrades to get the same one. It is slightly better than all of the other factions because you get a little bit more range out of the range upgrade than the speed and range upgrade of all the other factions. Also, Cybran, the other ones who are a little bit unique with their gun speed and range upgrade, it is combined, but of course they have to choose between T2 and speed and range. Very interesting to see that kind of play out. And down here to the southeast, we have ourselves a few Aurorae showing up to kill off a Mantis and try and shut down this expansion over here. Unfortunately, though, he's building mostly engineers, so this may work out, but the engineer is going to be dispatched very quickly to build out a T1 PD, and that will stop Aurora very well. Speed now on the way for xRawxLegitx. He's really just going to fully invest into a gun comm, and that could be very dangerous. If he pushes right through the middle, he could get to the main base of Mr. Hat and Claws, who's on 27 mass a second. Unfortunately, though, for xRawxLegitx, he's sitting on only about 4, and I think that's mainly because of a power stall, but he is in a very difficult position. He's going to be spending all of his economy on this upgrade. This is an all-in play. He has decided that the early game has gone so poorly that its only option is to walk towards the enemy with the most powerful unit on the field currently, which is, of course, going to be that gun speed and range comm. So we will have to see exactly how that one plays out. Very little interesting game state. Usually on this map, you would see somebody control K by this point. They're like, oh, well, you have multiple expansions and everything. In the higher levels, this is definitely a control K. Although in the higher levels, I feel like the players tend to do a little bit better at the expansion thing. But of course, we're here to check out the low level plays and just see how the average faffer gets around the day. And I also like this series a little bit because it encourages the new players. If you're new to FAF, or if you've never played FAF before, but you're interested, you watch these casts, and you thought, oh yeah, I'd want to get into it, but it seems complicated, it seems difficult. Trust me, the majority of players in this game, not good. It's okay to not be good at the game. It's very, very okay. I'm not good at the game. I only have one friend I play with consistently who I would consider good at the game. And then I have one who kind of inconsistently plays who is. Icy Nightmare and Thurnus are the only players that I consistently play with, I would say, who are good at the game at this point. I do play with some other pros, not as regularly as those two, though. And, of course, yet again, if you're interested in FAF, just try it. I promise. It goes on sale for like $1 every other week, it feels. But enough of me trying to tell everybody to play more FAF. Let's go ahead and get into the action over here. We have the Guncom out from xRawxLegitx starting to make its way towards the main base. But over here, we have a few Mantis showing up to this power line that's being spammed up by xRawxLegitx. Does he have AE storage? He has two of them, in fact. So all of these power generators that are being built up are just really going to help out the commander of xRawxLegitx in all of his actions here. But he's just so light on land units that it's going to be very difficult for him to put together an army big enough to really make an impact here. It's going to be very, very difficult for xRawxLegitx to get very much done here. There are about, I would say, I mean, I can literally look at it. It's about 20, maybe 25 units here. And that's not really going to threaten the comm of xRawxLegitx whatsoever. He does need more intel, would love to see a radar going up, but unfortunately all of his engineers here in the middle are going to be shut down and taken out. So now xRawxLegitx is just solo walking his comm towards the base of Mr. Hat and Claws, but that doesn't seem to be happening. He's gonna have to pull his comm back to deal with this large army out from Mr. Hat and Claws, and oh no, it's a disaster. He's losing a ton of power generators here in the middle. He's lost those engineers. He does luckily have a few Conservador interceptors out right now, almost called them ASF, and a T2 switch on both fronts for Mr. Hat and Claws, going for T2 land and air is going to be very useful for him. He's going to be able to build out those attacking air units like gunships and bombers, or the fighter bombers, I guess, is what they really are, Corsairs and Renegades, and those will be useful against a Guncom, especially since he just won air control away from xRawxLegitx. Now xRawxLegitx is going to start walking in towards the base here. A critical thing is he does have T2 on both of these, but right now there's no real units to stop this commander. So he's just going to be able to walk in and maybe kill it all off. A Renegade is going to be spammed out. Renegades, I actually learned very recently, is not all that great for dealing with a commander. They don't have a ton of DPS, but I still posit that they are better than nothing. So yeah, Corsair probably the better choice here, but of course that's just a little bit of tip for you all in the viewing audience. And xRawxLegitx going to just start walking his way in towards the base of Mr. Hat and Claws. The Renegades showing up, they're gonna start dealing some damage, but that T2 air HQ is going down very quickly to the fire coming out from xRawxLegitx. He has automatic overcharge turned on, it would seem. And he does bring in his few conservators that he's built up since the last air fight and kills off that Renegade. So this T2 air HQ is almost assuredly going down here. T1 AA built up by Mr. Hat and Claws over there on the right-hand side of our screen. And xRawxLegitx continuing to try and fight it out here. If he can get rid of all of the teched up stuff and get rid of all of these T2 mass extractors, he may still have a shot in this game. A few units for xRawxLegitx now starting to show up. And the engineers and the comm of Mr. Hat and Claws walking forward. This could be very dangerous for Mr. Hat and Claws. He is not going to be able to stand up to the overwhelming firepower that will be produced by this Guncom. There is a Rhino out on the field, but that's just an overcharge away from being dead. And now Mr. Hat and Claws is going to have to deal with a lot of damage being poured into that comm, and he's gonna be in a dangerous position. xRawxLegitx may just be able to walk him down, and xRawxLegitx may be able to just get a win here. If he just continues to walk down the comm of Mr. Hat and Claws, this could be a very, very early ejection here for the Red Cybern, but it doesn't happen. xRawxLegitx does not continue to chase down Mr. Hat and Claws, and Mr. Hat and Claws is going to be able to get out of range here in just a moment. It's not the end of the world for xRawxLegitx. He is still massively behind, but he still has this army here, and he still has the capability to keep walking into this base. A Cerberus or two will not stop a Guncom. And as long as he walks in and kills off the right targets here, he could be in a very good position. He could probably wipe this entire base if he's lucky. Needs to make sure he kills off those T2 engineers as they're currently building up Cerberus, and Cerberus are very, very dangerous to his current position in this game. Another Cerberus going up, but he's got a rank of veterancy that's going to help him out a little bit. He's trying to chase down all of the T2 engineers, and he may be able to get every single last one of them. They're all dead now, and now he can just focus down the Cerberus. He does need to worry about all of the DPS coming out from those Mantis, though. He's having a bit of a struggle here. And let's go ahead and turn back on the minimap. We can see that the comm of Mr. Hat and Claws there on the minimap starting to run down towards that southern expansion where he has T2 mechs set up there as well. But there's been some damage done onto the main base of xRawxLegitx, which means that this attack is even more all in than it already was. He needs to kill off this main base. He needs to get rid of all of this production and rebalance the slate if he wants to possibly win this game. He's going very, very low on HP, dropping into the red right there, but it does seem as though with some overcharges and with killing off all these units, he's going to be able to survive here. He may even be close to another rank of veterancy. There are still some Aurora over here trying to help him out with his efforts, killing off some T1 Pigeons. And of course, there are some Aurora coming from the middle of the map, but on the western flank over there on the minimap, you can see a ton of units coming out, and xRawxLegitx is still fighting this huge stream. This huge stream over here to the west of units out from Mr. Hat and Claws is almost assuredly going to spell the demise of the main base of xRawxLegitx. And now the commander of Mr. Hat and Claws sitting in the water. He has T2 land rebuilt over here. He's going to be able to get up T2 air if he wishes it again. He is sitting on a very strong economy of 61 mass a second. Although I don't see a lot of power built up over here or at this expansion. So if all of this power starts going down in rapid succession, that's going to put Mr. Hat and Claws into a horrible, horrible power stall. He needs to probably get out a T2 engineer somewhat soon, but he's building Wagners instead. So that way he can replace that T2 power generator. And xRawxLegitx continuing to fight it out. Four ranks of veterancy on the comm, 82 kills, getting a lot of value, gonna be able to shut down this T2 land HQ. Little does he know that there's already another one on the map, so this is really not going to achieve much. Needs to focus down the power. That will help him out a ton. Over to the west, a large attack now coming out from Mr. Hat and Claws. He's going to be making his way into the base. A T1 PD is going to be thrown out very quickly. Is there any Medusa in the mix? There are, and there's also Fervors over here to help out, and there's more PD going to be going up momentarily. Over here to the main base of Mr. Hat and Claws. He just lost that T2 Pigeon, and he is going to be spiraling into a power stall within the minute. And that is going to be very, very painful for him. He's gonna have to pause everything, start spamming out T1 PD, or T1 Pigeons, not PD. Because right now, I think he's back down all the way to his original power generation. Or if not, he's got some Hydros. The Hydros are helping him out quite a little bit here. But other than that, he is in a very rough spot power generation-wise because he has a lot of power demand and not a lot of power production. And now over here to the north, these four factories are going to be going down, and xRawxLegitx has successfully sweeped the entire base of Mr. Hat and Claws off the map. T2 Air was started up, but it's not going to be finished anytime soon. He is assisting it with a couple of engineers. It's up to about 10% now. And unfortunately for Mr. Hat and Claws, this power stall is really not helping his case. Needs to cut back on his power expenditure and build more power increasing facilities, or power production facilities, I should say. As that will be a sore spot for him for the moment. Mr. Hat and Claws sitting on a decent situation, and we may have a bit of a base trade situation. Although no, xRawxLegitx managing to hold his base. He's really coming back into this game and getting back into the swing of it. There's still a large standing army out over here for Mr. Hat and Claws, and he's going to be sending it over towards the commander of xRawxLegitx. Will xRawxLegitx be able to legitimately raw his way out? I don't know what rawing your way out is. That sounds horrible. But will he be able to get his way out of this situation? That's a lot of units to contend with. There's now some Wagners over here on the southern side. They're going to clean up these Auroras very easily. And that is going to be at least one Wagner going down. And now xRawxLegitx is in a situation. His comm is at 5 ranks of veterancy. He's not going to get any more boosts in HP. He does have that 40 HP a second, though, which is a lot to contend with. He does have 13,000 health on the commander currently. He's going to be under a lot of attack. Needs to just make sure he continues to take out the high damage targets. Those Wagners have great burst damage on their little rockets. It's not the giant plasma ball that does a lot of damage, but the tiny little rockets you're going to see coming out of these guys. And both Wagners going down there. And currently, xRawxLegitx, he's doing okay with dealing with this. He does have his Aurora now behind him. He can use those to try and help buffer the DPS and get some more damage down. And as long as he just doesn't immediately die to this large army coming out from Mr. Hattenclaws, he should be in a good position. Mr. Hattenclaws rebuilding his power grid now, rebuilding out those T1P gens, really setting himself up yet again to be in a decent position. xRawxLegitx, though, he's having to rely so heavily on this commander as a crutch to keep him in this game. He is getting so much value out of it. 13,000 mass killed, 138 kills on that comm. He is truly a Rambo comm if ever there was somebody deserving of said title. It's just a one-man army fighting off the hordes of the Red Menace. And xRawxLegitx now cleaning up the vestige of this force. Meanwhile, another attack coming up towards the main base of xRawxLegitx. Not really going to achieve too much there. A few more units coming out over here. Seems as though maybe some reclaim. Oh, nope, that's just an engineer told to go to the main base. That's going to be a very sad day for that engineer. And xRawxLegitx currently down to 3,300 HP. That's not a whole lot. Going down into the red very early. That's a lot of power generation now built up. He's getting a T2P gen. He has some things paused that will allow him to get this T2 air factory finished up most likely. And if he does that, we could see some Corsairs coming out to really deal with this commander that's been such a huge thorn in the side of Mr. Hattenclaws. And over here to the north, more Aurora coming out, trying to shut down some more of this eco production. A T1PD gonna be built to kill off like much less mass and mass extractors, but hey, gives you a little bit of security over there. Another T1 factory being built up now by xRawxLegitx over here on this northeastern base. Maybe he just wants to reclaim, maybe he just wants to rebuild here. Unfortunately for him, though, it's starting to look very dangerous with this southern side of the map. With Mr. Hattenclaws getting himself this T2 air factory online very quickly, that could be very dangerous. xRawxLegitx really doesn't have a handle on the air game currently. And he does scout. He will be able to see that T2 is finished up over here. He's sitting on a very strong position over here. And he needs to come up with a solution for it quick. Mr. Hattenclaws sitting on more mass per second than he had when he originally lost this, before he lost his base, because he's just been upgrading T2 mexes across the board. He still has a strong army too. So xRawxLegitx really in a difficult position here. He's just behind by most measurable metrics. Everything except for comm veterancy and number of kills on comm, he's behind in. And now with T2 air finishing up, we have a bunch of prowlers now being spammed out of this factory. And very soon, I would assume he's going to go for that aggressive air option. He's going to be going for some form of T2 air aggression to shut down this commander. He's constantly throwing armies over here trying to stop this commander from regening all the way up to full. With that quick reprieve, the commander going from 3,000 HP to 8,000, 40 health a second does regen you very quickly. But now with xRawxLegitx having to fight against all of these units constantly. He's just struggling a bit. He's about to surpass 200 kills on this commander. 81, 82, 83, 84. Oh my, we're gonna get a 200 kill commander. We're going to have 200 kills on this one unit that you start the game with. How quaint. And xRawxLegitx, he may not win games, but he damn sure makes them interesting. As we see Corsairs start to come up on the mini-map to try and focus down this commander. And I think that this may be the beginning of the end here. Let's go ahead and just get a cinematic view as we watch this commander do its thing. We have the mini-map to track things. The Corsair is still here. The Medusa are still trying to deal with it. Oh, it follows overcharges. And that commander running for the water. Unfortunately for him, though, the existence of torpedo bombers will mean that this is not an effective strategy. Let's just go ahead and maybe get a... Yeah, that's a cool shot. All right, enough with me playing camera. Playing with my camera. xRawxLegitx now in the water, 2,500 HP, can survive one pass of a torpedo bomber, possibly two. But unfortunately for him, he's gonna have to deal with multiple torpedo bombers very, very soon. And I think that this is check, and very soon, xRawxLegitx will make his last move, and it will be checkmate. xRawxLegitx now taking damage on the comm. Actually, will be able to survive against the torpedo bombers for a while, especially if some of these shells hit the ground. The regen really making it easier for him to survive the damage coming out from the torpedo bombers. And for some reason, I was overestimating how much damage they did. And now with these Medusa firing on this hill, I have the high ground, Anakin! You underestimate my power! And now xRawxLegitx trying his best. This hill really helping xRawxLegitx, actually. It's making life a lot easier for him dodging the Corsairs. You'll notice the Corsairs, they come in at a very sharp angle, so whenever they have to deal with a change in the Z-axis, which is what I'm gonna call up and down, X and Y being... Well, I guess... Yeah, it's changing in three axes, and the Corsair is not particularly accurate. And xRawxLegitx is almost dead. I want to see how many kills this comm gets. So we're going to keep this up for now. He's up to 200, 231. Oh, but he's going to go down momentarily. 251 kills on that commander. And after a hard-fought game, he has lost one. We're gonna have to find a game where xRawxLegitx wins. Two losses in a row here on Willow's Duality's channel. And I would like to thank you all for watching. If you would like to support the channel more and get your name at the end of videos, Patreon is a wonderful way to do so. Or if you'd like to get access to all of these casts a little bit early, 12 to 24 hours is the general rule, check out the channel membership. You all are beautiful. I hope to see you in my next live streams and my next videos. This is Willow, signing off. I don't ever slow up, no, I don't take shit. I got no love for the fakeness. If you wanna play tough and wanna hate this, I'll always show up. I don't ever slow up, no, I don't take shit. I got no love for the fakeness. If you wanna play tough and wanna hate this, I'll always show up and make a statement.